Right.
Well, so I'm going to start here, and while everyone is finding their chairs, happy here to welcome EM2N and Mathias Müller and Daniel Niggli. I believe they're here today to talk about recent projects. Before that, just a brief introduction to their offices. They have offices in Zurich and Berlin. And most recently, they have completed projects for this Swiss film archive, as well as the IEM-LM viaduct. They're both visiting professors at the EPFL and ETH. This semester, they have been spending some of their time here in Istanbul at Bilgi University, together with Medine for teaching. So, we'd like to pass on the word to you, Mathias, and looking forward to your talk.
Well, thanks a lot, Gregor. It's wonderful to be here again. I think I will do this in English. Pürchen, Dras Saif. You can check then, böyle bir sunum söylemek için yeterli değil. Ama olsun. I will speak English or also probably could speak German, but I think English is the language best suited for everybody. We will speak about, well, recent projects, but we will filter them. Together with Medine, we proposed a studio here at Bilgi when we were speaking about transformations. Why transformations? We believe transformations is actually a topic which is completely underrated, underestimated in architecture. Modern architecture actually started with a very different plan. Our heroes, which we were taught at school, they were mostly concerned with bringing to the world a new reality. This is Le Corbusier's hand, a godlike hand over the city, and the project he's proposing in Paris is actually tearing apart half of the city, really demolishing everything. This kind of mindset of modernism, this kind of degré zero starting from new, actually found a terminating point then in the famous Krokodil apartments, which was then kind of a finale for the end of modernism, at least it was defined as such by critics. This is the kind of utopia which is supposed to give everybody equal distribution of light and so on, purely scientific principles, you know all the story, but of course demolishing was kind of that, kind of admitting that that utopia actually failed. And ever since, we believe architects have been looking for a new kind of grand story to tell, or for a new kind of outlook, for a new kind of perspective on how to think architecture. And we believe that we don't have to look so far. André Kobo introduced into the architectural debate the image of the palimpsest, the image of the overwriting of old skins, overwriting of old documents, creating layer over layer of meaning, and we believe that architecture actually for centuries, for thousands of years, has also functioned like that. So, if we want to talk about examples that fascinate us, we often, for example, take the Palace of Diocletian. So, when the Roman Emperor retired from Rome, when he went back home to his own place where he was coming from Split, he built himself a magnificent kind of palace, which was of course modeled on the Roman image of the city, Cardo de Comanos, important buildings and so on. And when you go there today, of course, you all know this, you find this fascinating kind of melange of old and new. And it's interesting to see how the general idea is still readable, the general concept of the city is very strongly still, it can be related to the idea of the palace of the Roman city. But when you go closer and when you look and observe all the layers, you can see how it's also lost a lot of its kind of totalitarian strictness, rigidness, and it's actually kind of evolved into this crazy melange of elements from all times, and even the most modern layer, even today's layer, we believe actually works beautifully. It's not a problem, but it actually adds just another layer. And we believe that architects should much more try to think in this kind of framework and to really kind of try to just add the next layer if possible. Because when you look at something like that, it actually carries a lot of meaning. And I think that's something we really sorely lack in today's cities, this kind of richness of meaning, is when we start from scratch. Of course, this architectural theory has been used long ago. One of the heroes we constantly refer to is José Pechnik, who did this wonderful little church in Bogojina. We've never been to it, but we studied the plans carefully. What you see is an original church, a small chapel, and he was asked to make it bigger, to build a new church. And soon after he visited the building site, he actually came back with the idea of really starting from the old and then doing something new. So what you see in the dark parts are actually original. The new parts, yellow is demolition, the new parts are red. And what you see is a complete reversal of the idea of the church. The direction changes and the old church actually becomes the entrance space for the new church. And then all kinds of crazy things happen. For example, the way that this tower is inserted, or the way that roofs intersect, the way that things are turned around. Or for example here, when you look at the big space, you notice the old facade, how it's cut open, and actually you have these hanging elements here, which are completely reinterpreted in their carrying mode. And the old outdoor space where the monks were wandering around is not then actually the basis for the new church space. So this is a space which is very complex and which carries a lot of meanings into each other, and actually we love that very much, that you can bring one element in more than one way. So when we were asked to do a publication on our work for ETH, we actually put together a lot of the references we work with, and we discovered that most of the references that we pinned up on the walls of our office were actually renovations. And that made us aware actually of the fact that we are probably renovation architects. Could be that this is one of our strong points. So for that reason, and because of our love of this kind of complex kind of operations, I will show you now a series of old and new projects which exclusively deal with renovation. So the first project takes us to the periphery of Zurich. This is a kind of modernist planning, very low bungalow type of prefabricated housing, and our client was living here. And he was a lawyer. And the interesting thing was that the tapu was actually this big, and if he wanted to do any extension to his house, he would have to talk to all of his neighbors, which lawyers don't like to do. So we went to look at the building law, and we discovered this. He can be free of any worries. He can actually extend his house underground. So we went to this guy and we said, why don't we build you something which, for example, in this lovely building from Northern Africa, has been done for centuries. It's very foreign to the Swiss context, but it's actually a very interesting, very specific typology. And it's actually something which only the absurdity of Swiss law can generate in Switzerland. So what we did was, we added this kind of new organism to the old organism of the house. This is the basement stair going down. We cut it off, built a new stair, and did two courtyards. In Switzerland, when you want to build, of course, you have to kind of show where the building is. We built little wooden skeletons to indicate that, and the neighbors were quite shocked when they discovered the big hole which we made in the garden. But then, after we finished building, it returned to normal, and there was just this kind of disturbing railway sitting in the garden, showing that there is something underneath. Now, the surprising thing about the new house is that the new house is much more fun than the old house, because down under the ground, there are not so many rules. Your neighbors, they don't look into your apartment. You can run around naked if you want, because they're not seeing into it. So we were able to do big glass surfaces. We were able to introduce a little bit of fun. This rubber mat here was then only reduced afterwards when the kids were actually picking up their knees bloody on that wood down there. So even our design was also redesigned. And you see how the new house is much more open than the above house. So sometimes doing something absurd will allow you to go to a certain degree of freedom and to do things which normally you would not do. Also, we were able to experiment with colors like the bathrooms and really go crazy down there. Even in the end, they requested from us an underground movie theater, which we then added again. So after that little adventure, that little North African adventure, which was generated by the building law, Daniel and I also tried to be speculators. We believe that the role of the architect is a role which should be interpreted. It's frowned upon in Europe, but especially in Germany, for example, it's strictly forbidden, but in Switzerland, architect is not a profession which is protected. So anybody can be architects, and also architects can be speculators. And we said, why don't we start earning money, really money, you know, not just a fee, but really money, by buying a building and turning that building into something else. So we bought this wonderful supermarket here, which was an old, small supermarket, which was not really, you know, the big menu, 3M was next to it, so it was out of work. And it was actually a banal building, no one wanted it, no one was seeing the potential of it, but we actually were fascinated by this wonderful 4.5 meter tall space. The other thing that was interesting is if you did a renovation of this building, you would be able to build much more square meters than if you took it away, because the building law had changed in the meantime. So this was the concept, very kind of bourgeois concept, you do 5 houses, on the 5 sides of the building. And the trick now here was to actually leave this tall space and then do something in sections. You see we actually introduced 2 floors here, and we were able also to introduce 1 more floor here. So we were able to keep part of the building, that tall space here. And then of course the trick is to kind of bring that into relationship with each other. The floor plans are also something that probably you would not do if you were building a new house. So this is what we enjoy, that in renovations, things happen that we normally would not do. So in this house, we then tried to do interior facades. I know you guys have seen a wonderful house in Ivory, which has exactly that. So the idea actually to have an exterior facade and an interior facade, and even to bring in the light from the top, to do all these crazy windows, to open up all these kind of side relations and so on. We enjoy that very much. And we don't think that we would have done that in a new building, only in a renovation probably. Something like this is possible. So for us, renovating is actually like making more interesting projects possible sometimes, because it actually allows us to think things which we would probably not think if we were building new. This is an interesting apartment. One of the families wanted to do something with color. So we said, if you want to colorize your apartment, we know a nice color artist. So they came up with this really crazy color scheme, and they even renovated our own design. So they took our white blank design and added their color levels, which is then again very nice. When you do something and then someone else takes it and does something else with it. This is very interesting. I know a few architects who probably freak out about something like this, but we actually enjoy it a lot when the people bring in their own next layer. From the outside, and this is probably very Swiss, but it's also a little bit our personalities. From the outside, we try to hide everything. We try not to scream, we try to be good citizens. So the thing is quite nondescript. Only you get a little bit of an idea here, because you see these windows kind of telling a strange story, so you kind of wonder what's going on in there. And then of course we hope that people get curious and they actually inquire about the inside of this. But we like to really not scream around in public, we like to kind of lay it down. Okay, renovations have also helped us a lot when dealing with difficult places. This is the state archive of a small canton of Basel. They keep their records there, they keep their books, public records. It's a small building and it needed to be about doubled in size. Istal, the place where this is happening, is a very traditional city. You see here the city core. You see the station, the public buildings and so on, the hospital, the government buildings, and then there is a train line cutting the valley into two. And the problem of the state archive was that together with the lunatic asylum, it was on the wrong side of the tracks. So it did not have an address. So when we did the competition, our thesis was actually to keep the existing building as much as possible for cost reasons. It didn't make sense to pull it down, but to completely change it, to change those volumes which were actually one next to the other one, add some new ones, and then give it a new address on top, so that the new building would communicate with the other buildings across the railroad track. And then this strange thing here is a kind of a mediating device. So we were trying actually to tie together a few parts under a common skin, which is wonderful sketch by Sanayi, of course, which architects like to use a lot. It's wonderful to kind of conceal something underneath, conceal a grown situation underneath. You can see here again the new and the old parts. And I'll go straight on to here. So the situation now has completely changed. In this residential neighborhood, all of a sudden there's a different kind of building. It's a different kind of scale, of course. And going up to the second floor, it actually starts communicating to the other side. Of course, the materialization also went on. We were trying to give it the kind of allure of a public building with a glass facade. At the same time, we were trying not to be a bad neighbor in this neighborhood. This is why we chose this green facade, which now is completely green all the way to the top, which kind of mediates to the neighbors and also takes up that green element of the railroad dam. So this kind of building is also the strategy of not really telling what's inside. You kind of go in, and then of course there's a problem how to get people up there. And we invented this kind of space, which probably in a new building they would never let you build, because it's completely absurd. It's an empty space, and there's a strange stair coming down, and there's this concrete, this layered concrete, which kind of symbolizes the activity of storage. And then you go to the kind of middle floor and up. And when you go up, you emerge into this open floor, which is kind of modern, kind of spacious, and also it signifies control, because the kind of documents that people get handed out there, which they look at, they kind of have to be kept under control. So it's all glass, under supervision. People can sit there. There's a small library also down there. So we like to work with these kind of opposites, concealing from the outside and then kind of surprising people with a new kind of world on the inside. If we now go from buildings to urbanism, also we believe that transformations can be very interesting. Of course, you have it here in Istanbul a lot, but also in Switzerland we have these industrial areas. Which are very important kind of key areas for the transformation of the city. The question is always, how do you deal with the character of something like this? How do you, on one hand, preserve the character that it offers, the identity? How do you protect the character and at the same time develop it into the future? We were very lucky to win the competition for this place, which is a textile factory in Brücken near Luzern. And the strategy which we adopted was actually really to kind of respect these huge conglomerates of buildings and to really not erase anything, but just kind of opt for a gradual kind of transformation. The strategy came from our fascination with the place as it existed. This is almost a little city. So when you walk in, you see this. You see an industrial area, which is actually very urban. You see a street space, which is not quite a street space. So there's no sidewalks, really. It's kind of just an open surface. But you have these lovely kind of transitional spaces going into the houses. And you have these very, very carefully done facades. which are kind of like an alphabet over the time of industrial typology. So we were fascinated by that lovely care which the architects had used when they were placing the buildings together. And we decided to just really kind of keep this strategy here and just kind of show how one building after another one could be replaced, new kind of courtyards could be inserted, but walking through these spaces you would still have the same character preserved. We tried to show this in models, because in models you can show very easily by bringing in and taking out when you present a project. It's very understandable also for people. And also we like models because they kind of carry a message which is not so precise as rendering. So you're not forced to do this super realism, but you can just kind of let people's imagination grow a little bit. So we work very heavily with these kind of models to convince people to keep the character of the place. We won the competition, and again we were very lucky because the canton wanted to place a part of a school, of art school, to this area, concentrated there, and we were faced with this building, which we should transform. Now this kind of building is a strictly functional building. Fascinating about this one is that since they were actually testing production processes, it was kind of a lab, it was almost kind of a research facility, and they had built it with a completely free span of, I think it was 22 meters, correct me if I'm wrong. So we actually analyzed that structure and built a model of it, just showing that structure, and completely fell in love with it. And I think at that point we decided that the best thing to do with the building was actually just to really kind of take it like a shelf in which you could fill in anything. So of course we had to redo the facade, which is a difficult thing without spoiling the whole atmosphere. And we had to do a kind of a new floor plan for the building. But other than that, actually, it was very, very useful. If you have this kind of a shelf, it's very easy to stack functions, even very different functions. And also it's fascinating that it's also in a very long-term, probably flexible. So this kind of a building, it kind of allows you really to think in very abstract terms and just kind of think architecture like kind of in your apartment. You put the books to the shelves and then you can rearrange the books. So you see here the walls which we broke down, only the yellow walls. We were trying to use as many walls which were existing as possible, also because the cost had to be kept down. You can see how the facade was doubled with thermal insulation, but other than that, architecturally very little change. The most decisive change was on that side, where they had a stacking device, like a silo for goods with a robot in it going around, kind of a storage facility. We broke that away and did a new facade. So when you go up, you see how the plants are very deep, those 22 meters, and there's a very natural way of dealing with it. You just take the spaces which don't need as much light, and you bring them to the inside, and you arrange the other ones. On the other side, we try to keep the circulation as little as possible and just make spaces as big as possible for the students and the administration. So this is now the new image of the area. These are still kind of untouched buildings. They will be converted later. We were able to do a new public park on that side, and the building is reacting here with this new facade, where we took off that storage facility. It was interesting to take the fire escape issue and come up with a solution, a cheap solution. We did an outdoor kind of stair attached to the building. Also, we tried, we were very happy with the way that this kind of element, without spending much money, is actually giving a new image to the building, kind of showing that there is a new use for it. There are very minimal things done to the building. You kind of use some color, you know, use the number, the industrial houses were numbered. You use number as a new identity tool. You bring a new facade very similar to the old one. And that's about it. Here you see that the transformation strategy, the urbanistic, is already showing itself. This is the place where another building will come. It will be built by Ali Cooper, a friend of ours. He used to work for Atatürk Demiral, now he has his own office. So here we just kept the place for the other building and it will be stuck on later. So you can kind of see how it changes gradually, one after the other one, and one building leaves an imprint in the other one. It's sometimes very nice to use these kind of fire escape things to create nice spaces like the balcony. It's an excuse. If you would tell the client, I want a balcony in front of my school, he would say that you're crazy, but you can tell him, no, we need a fire escape, we'll pay for it, and the students can hang out on it. And other than that, it's a very minimalistic strategy because we believe that that is actually the character of the place. On the inside, you kept the old floor, just kind of fixed it in some places where it was broken. And the new elements which we introduced, like this bar, we tried to keep it down as much as possible. It's a design school, so we don't want to kill everything by over-designing. We actually want to open a kind of field of possibilities for the students there. This is already one intervention. It was a student competition. Daniel was in the jury. They decided that none of the entries were good enough, but they did it anyway. So that's also very nice. It's like kids, when you have kids, you know, you make kids and then try to educate them, and then they do everything the other way. It's lovely. It's actually very nice also in architecture sometimes in a funny way to lose control. These kind of wonderful spaces, it's still the same staircase. They came up with this balcony here. They had to kind of go around twice because the spaces are so high, so you have a wonderful staircase with a balcony. We didn't do anything here. And now you can observe how the students and the staff on the first day, they're coming in, they're bringing their things, they're installing their things, and they're adding like a new layer to all the layers which were there. So that's very, very nice also when you go back to your project after you've delivered it, you actually see what people do with it. And sometimes it's quite surprising. For example, I would have never thought that we would install swings. Yeah. So it's a kind of architectural position that tries to do as little as possible to kind of create a free space for people to react to. So when we speak about the city, this is the city of Zurich, of course, with the airport and the lake and the central city. The industrial areas have been very important. These red spaces are actually the only spaces where the city is really free to evolve and free to kind of develop. In this part of the city here, we have our office here. This is the industrial part close to the city center. You can see how much change that has been going on. All these buildings, and it's still going on, have been renewed or changed. And it just shows you how quickly that process is going. And the question, of course, is always, how do you kind of steer such a process without the city losing its identity? It's always kind of a walk on the edge between protecting and killing things and replacing things and so on. You can see also that new scale which was introduced here. We have a city model. It's a space as big as this. It's a 1 of 1,000 scale, I believe. And whenever a new project is done, they place it in, and you can see these kind of things. This is the project for the football stadium, which eventually was not realized. This new scale, which is coming to the city, big debate. And you can also see in this picture maybe how really the new is kind of clashing sometimes in a good way and sometimes not in such a good way in the city. So I will show you now a few of the projects in which we were involved, which play in this part of the city. One is a kind of adaptation. You mentioned Vegas. It's an adaptation of a infrastructure. We believe that infrastructures are very, very important in cities. You notice, of course, from Istanbul, from many cities, the kind of traces that people bring in they stay forever. For example, this railroad viaduct here was done 100 years ago, and it was done very carefully. You can see this contemporary artist did a piece of art, and you can see how people were fascinated by the fact that the traffic was brought to the second level, that there were views framed into the city and so on. So these were, at the time, disruptive things, but they carried a high degree of fascination with them. Of course, what also helped the city digest this piece, and what also helped people to identify with it, was the care with which it was done. You will realize here that the city at the time when this was built was not yet developed, and the engineer who did this viaduct decided to use stone here in these places where there later would be the houses, and they used very nice light steel bridges here to bridge the streets in order to enable a kind of permeability. So if you do an infrastructure in this degree, with this degree of care and with this degree of kind of love for the city, and if you think it together with the city, it can be, first of all, more sympathetic to the place, and then you can start actually enjoying a life of its own, which we witnessed. This is actually the part of the viaduct which is going down the lake. This is going today out to the airport, to Berlin, to the other part. This is still in operation until today, but this was then abandoned. And at the time when this was abandoned, they had a competition, and they asked us to rethink that viaduct. What it had been actually, it had been kind of a place where there were storage facilities and so on within the city. And they wanted to clear out all these things down there which had grown over the years. They wanted to renovate the stone, and they wanted to make a new walkway up here, and they asked us to imagine that kind of renovation down there. So when we tried to find out a position to this task, we went to look to infrastructural buildings over time. What you can find a lot, you can find a lot of bridges which are in fact inhabited. Like this one here, I believe it's in France. So you can see how these infrastructure elements in history were not just thought as pure infrastructures, but always they were hybrids. They were kind of oscillating between usable structures, houses, and parts of infrastructure. And they were always really thought as part of the city. You can also observe the opposite. When the Roman Empire collapsed and the population of Europe went down in the ages after Rome because of war and decimation of population and so on, the cities retreated to their course. So here, this is in Arles, I believe, this is the Roman theater, and the city actually retreated into this theater and actually merged together with the theater. It became a kind of an infrastructure or monument and city hybrid. And what's nice about it is it's not really possible to say where one starts and the other one stops. It's kind of a hybrid also in an architectural sense. It's not, it's often when you deal with old structures, people try to bring in something strikingly new which opposes the old. But in these examples, you see that kind of architectural coexistence. And finally, when we did the project, we opted exactly for such a strategy. We said the viaduct is actually such a great place that we want to still have it in the foreground. We want to keep it as the main player, and our new intervention should just be very, very slight, and it should not disturb it. So we opted here to fill out all these wonderful arches. The other competitors, most of them, put little houses underneath the arches, little tiny houses, little architectures. We said, no, 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 we don't want to do this. We just want to fill it up. We want this to be still the protagonist. And then up here, where the two infrastructures were parking, right, where there's a special geometry, we kind of tried from this here, from that kind of geometry, to develop kind of a special place. So what also was very interesting is that the city, from the start, they were actually formulating the need for the this pedestrian connection on the first floor, which later then would go on to the other side of the city, and we were actually asked to incorporate it. So this is the result today. You can see that building in the front, it's a market hall. Well, the Swiss version of a market hall. I think all over the world there's more livelier market halls than this, unfortunately. You see here the pedestrian walk on the first floor, which is actually a great thing because you get to experience the city from another level, and it kind of gives you a new connection, which I was never thought like this in the city. Framing the views, so going back to that contemporary picture from 100 years ago, really now making that possible, bringing that to the people. Connecting the lower floor with the upper floor, bringing in light, but light in the sense that we are not lighting our new intervention, but we are kind of lighting the spaces that exist between ours and the existing. And then of course that infinite multitude of fill-ins, infills again, people who did their own thing, and which then adds a second layer of life to the intervention, which our intervention, which is kind of very discreet and very kind of tying together. So the strategy was actually very simple, but difficult to do, because here, of course, it was able to do a roof and to insulate this, but the thing up there, it was still in operation, there are still trains going, and that stone viaduct has no waterproofing. So we were forced to tell our clients that actually some rainwater, and also in Switzerland still some trains and toilets which empty the tracks, so some other water also, might actually come down here, and it might actually exit inside the spaces. So imagine that, the Swiss control freaks, the architect comes, and we tell them, maybe. So what we did, we just did a kind of a water gutter here, you patch up the water. Yeah, there are still a lot of problems with this building. We are now, at the moment, making a concept to renovate our own roofs, because some things aren't the way they're supposed to do. We still have water coming in, but it's living and it's actually working. This is one unit. We did the bare minimum. We just did hung in that kind of floor. This is a toilet and the infrastructural unit, and that's the end of it. And here the front hall, that market hall, which on the other hand then we left open one space as a sitting space for the restaurant. And then we were very interested in, with our new intervention, kind of take up the materiality of the stones, to honor the stones, but to come with a new material. So this is kind of a rubber insulation thing. There's a soft insulation underneath it. We screwed it down with these pins, and it kind of enters into a dialogue. And then here the space of the market hall with the restaurant from inside, with this kind of geometry which is developed from the geometry of the two infrastructures parking. All right, I'll come to a project which has actually been in our office, I would say, the main project or one of the main projects for 9 years. So it actually kind of grew with us and also really kind of almost killed us at times and changed us also, the way we look at architecture, the way we do projects. It's a Tomi Areal, so I showed you this, now we're going out here. Tomi is actually the place where about one third of the Swiss milk production was turned into cheese and into yogurt and ice cream and all kinds of wonderful things. But as you know also, this is not a very successful economy. So it's heavily subsidized. Swiss milk is much too expensive. No one buys this. So this cooperative which was went bankrupt, I think, 17 years after this, and below this dairy. So it was the most modern dairy factory of Europe, and 17 years later, I think, it went bankrupt. So the main bank financing this was the State Bank of our canton. Not a very nice thing to have this kind of industrial ruin on your hands. a room which is actually a pure image of the production process. So what they were doing was they were bringing the milk, they were storing it here vertically in these tanks. Then you can see these kind of flows, they were making powder and they were kind of bringing it to the spaces for production, ice cream production and so on. And then they were kind of storing it and then hauling it out on that side. So here this is a vertical storage tank, this is a kind of a big shelf, 6 meters, 7 meters height between the floors, and then this big ramp for the trucks to come to the building. So when the banks had this on their books, the lucky coincidence was that at the same time the city of art, the school of art was looking for a new place. And they were merging it with the school of music and drama and so on. So the idea was to make this huge campus. When we first were invited to the competition, we were actually kind of exhilarated and also shocked at the same time. Kind of exhilarated by these spaces. I mean, this is like a Piranesi painting, but you actually walk through it. This is the space where they had the tanks. They took them out and sold them to everywhere. I think from Turkey to Ukraine to China, these tanks are now standing and producing again. And this is the vertical part, and this is the horizontal part, that endless kind of just the field of possibilities. So we were exhilarated by the spaces, but we were daunted or shocked by the scale of it. This is the existing School of the Arts. This is ETH, where we studied, the main building by Semper. And in red, you always see the size of the site. This is the Tate Modern by Atatürk. Now this, of course, the addition has been done over on that side, and this is the Pompidou, it's kind of hanging out on that side. So we said, oh my god, what's this? How are we going to do this? Kind of a, well, young, not young, but kind of small architecture office dealing with this kind of a huge task. How are we going to do this? And the problem, of course, was that all these schools, they were housed in little houses all over the city, and they loved their little houses because also they had the little you know, kingdoms. Every teacher was kind of in his little cute house, and he was keeping his own house. And all these places would then be merged into this huge kind of campus, and of course that scares people. It scares people socially, but also in terms of organization, but also kind of in terms of the sheer numbers. People are scared, especially in Switzerland, of these big things. And then we were terrified also by the program. When we, in the office, when we get a new competition, always we ask the competition team to draw all the spaces, and we ask them to color code them. You know, the ones that need light, the ones that have acoustic requirements, the ones that are according to size, and they were drawing them all and placing them next to each other, and those with a kind of diagnosis don't need the light and so on. And it became more and more and more, and it just never stopped. And we said, oh my god, how are we gonna ever gonna organize this? How are we going to find a principle for this? We don't know anything about all these spaces. We're not specialists for this and that. And so we just filled it into the building, and it looked like a little city. And at that point, we understood that we were actually building a little city, and maybe we were not doing architecture, but we were actually doing an urbanistic we're dealing with an urbanistic problem, doing an urbanistic project. This is the density. So the question of how to make such a huge density tolerable is also a big question. And what we started out with actually was saying we like the building. We like the building, although it's completely arbitrary, it's just the image of that production process. But what's cool about it is it has a high part, it has a low part, and it has a kind of a very nice industrial look to it, and it's been a landmark in Zurich in that part. So we decided to not obliterate it, but actually to exaggerate it. So we said, let's make the high part higher, and let's make the low part kind of, let's renovate that and put some things on top, and especially make that roof really exciting. And very kind of in a cursory way, we said, okay, apartments maybe up here, because they're away from the traffic noise. Kind of also in Zurich, we didn't have at that time so many apartments and towers, so they enjoy a view. The schools, one school we put here, the other one there, and that's about it. So we kind of did a very rough kind of estimate where things would go. And now, of course, urbanistically, I've spoken about our fascination with the landmark building, which was sitting there. I'll make a jump now to what it's today. So you almost kind of recognize it. You almost kind of recognize it in terms of material, but certainly in terms of silhouette. And there is this kind of head standing up at the big intersection. And that's marking the spot in the city. And it's also kind of answering, of course, to the huge empty space of the railroad tracks and anchoring the building in the city. And as such, as a huge building which is anchored in the city, it's also becoming part of a growing number of buildings like these ones, old industrial areas, which also assert themselves in the cities and which act actually like small implants within the city. But then the question, of course, was how to anchor this huge beast in the city, how to prevent the danger of that thing becoming completely autonomous and completely also forbidding to the outside. So we analyzed the footpath network around there. Foot traffic and bicycle traffic is very important in Zurich. Not so much the car, public transport also. And we said what we should do actually, we should take up these footpath, and what we should try to do, we should connect them through the building here. You've seen these ramps, these delivery ramps, which are very, very kind of strong element, and which have been also added to the image. We were saying, okay, we could leave them, we could use them as footpaths, we could use them as streets, and we could connect them also through the building. So in a first kind of an act, we were actually doing a urbanistic operation within the building. So we were saying, okay, we have a big building, we know roughly where is what, and now we're going to create streets. So we are creating a huge hall connecting through the building. We are building big ramps leading up into the building. We are kind of rethinking these ramps as kind of a boulevard, like an urbanistic piece. And then all we have to do is connect these elements within the building, and we will create a system of circulation, which then will enable us to place the functions according to where we want them, in terms of their being public or not public, in terms of their needs, in terms of light, and so on. So this is how we arrived at the plan. This is the big hall you see here. This is the big ramp. It's an old plan. This changed later because we don't have this theater in here. It's now a museum. This is the other side leading down the street. And this is the start of the ramps. And you can already see here, on the ramp side also we have accesses. So we are creating actually two sides, this side and that side, and then connecting in the middle. When we had achieved this, it was actually much easier to speak about the placement of functions, because then we had criteria. We said, okay, I mean, if we want, for example, a cafe, to place a cafe, the cafe should probably be on the main square. So the main square is the big ball down there, so we placed the cafe right next to it. And there was not a discussion about this. People found it very logical and very understandable. So this helped us a lot in the discussion with the users, because in this 9-year process of planning and building, of course, everything changed. Like I mentioned, the use of this changed. This big ball down here should have been a kind of a hall for happenings and so on. That changed later on, just in workshops. And this connecting figure then, we tried to really keep it and not touch it, and it actually was never touched. And even we were able to extend it into the tower part, into the high part. And we were even, I'll talk about this later, we were even able to preserve some of that Piranesian kind of spatial property. So the operation is actually quite simple. Now when you talk about building, we take the existing, looked like this, we cleaned it out, so this immense just kind of field of possibilities.
No. to the angry Steve Jobs. Very good.
Oh, now it's all gone. This is also beautiful though. Restart here. Yeah. Oh, this is wrong side of the universe, is it?
Why do you know Turkish?
I didn't understand, sorry.
Why do you know Turkish?
Why do I know Turkish? It's my hobby. No, this Uzun Hikaye. No, but... Bunun için Türkiye'ye geldik. Ama sadece bir club içinde kaldık. Çünkü çok korktuk. Türkiye'den ve Türklerden falan. Yabancı bir yer ya. Ve çok güzeldi. Hava güzeldi, deniz güzeldi falan. Çok beğendik ama havalimanından to the club and back we went. Not going out. Sonra the club went bankrupt. But problem with it, bizim tiketlerimizi aldı. Ve iptalı geri gelmek mümkün değildi. Gittik ve gerçek Türkiye'ye gittik ve şaşırdık. Çok güzel var, çok güzel insan var, yer böyle yaban değil falan. And then we were in Turku place. Yeah, nice. We're staying in a small patio. No, very nice people. They spoke German. Çok şükür. And I went everywhere and I saw these signs. I said, what's a salatilik? Salatilik. And he said, no, a satilik. It means to sell. And I said, oh, that's amazing. Everything is for sale here. So I said, can you learn me the price? And so he learned the price and he said, ooh, that's very expensive. But my dream started then to have a piece of land on the sea. So then we started discovering and we ended up in a small village, Mazepe. It's really on the side and there's no one there. There, in a kind of a delirium, we bought a big piece of land. And ever since, we have been in the system.
Mazıköy.
Biliyor musun Mazıköy?
No, biliyorum.
Çok güzel. Mumcuları tanıyoruz. Belki.
Mumcu.
Tanıyorsunuz. Mumcular. Mumcularla öğrene gidiyorsunuz. Öğren. Gökobaköy'de, Körfezi'de. Büyük bir termik santral var. Bu yolda Mazıköy var.
Mazıköy.
Yukarı Mazı var, aşağı Mazı. Biz aşağı mağazada kalıyoruz çünkü yukarı mağazada gider tamamen deli. Değişik insanlar. Okay. Devam edelim. They're very normal. It's like in Switzerland. One guy says the other one is crazy, but they're all crazy. So what we did was we were actually just perforating like model building, cutting that building. You can see here the tool, that big saw, cutting through the concrete. Opening up spaces for light, and then because it was so high, we were able to insert these new floors in steel, like you see here, and then up. Very basic. So we'll go through now. I'll spare you all the further details. So you see the inner circulation figure, the inner urbanism. You see the light wells, you see the cores which we need to circulate. And of course, then a system of paths, like a small subcut. And here, then that ramp. That ramp became very important because we said if we have that wonderful ramp, we can really use it for addressing, also for programming. And on the other side, of course, also ramps leading up into the building. After the ramps then, outdoor spaces to connect with the city, kind of welcoming spaces, which also can be used to, you know, expose art and new happenings, or also to smoke, very important. And then those big kind of spaces, this is now the big hall, and in a very natural way, we have the cafe here. And we were actually trying to create facades like you would find in a city. And we were using kind of furniture which Swiss people use in gardens or in cafe restaurants. So we were actually trying very literally to carry that image of the city into the building and to create kind of an outdoor space. We had a very nice cooperation with some guys from Berlin. They are media artists, and we actually first, the principal of the school, he said, I want some flashy things on the outside. He said, we want a multimedia facade. We said, we're not so sure about it. What are you going to show? So we invited these two guys to help us convince this guy that we should do something different with the building. And they actually said, what you have as a tool is the light. The light is a big problem in these kind of buildings. You have light everywhere, and it has to be at a certain level, but that makes people very tired. So they said, what we can do, we can take the light which you have now, and you can actually place them in some places and create more light in some places. When you sit here, you're always burning, and in the back, it's kind of dark. Like in the city also, when you go outside, it's dark in some places and light in some other places. And they were arguing also in an urbanistic way. Realities United, they're called. Our office is now also in their office in Berlin. We're working together a lot. And they were actually just helping us rearrange things. These kind of things, we left them in the spaces. These are traces of the use. And as you go up, you have a lot of questions about scale, how big to make a stair so that we can use it. So that the spaces will be more than just a kind of a circulation space, but really kind of a city space. I'll show you now some pictures of how this space, the central space, was being used, for example, at the big school happening, which we're having for the opening. Or, for example, when Monsieur Hollande, the French president, was coming to visit, they were using it as a stage for the dancers. Or when they feel like they just have a big party there, and their own bands are playing. So it's a kind of a space, like a city square in which you would hold festivals and you would kind of reprogram it according to your needs. There are many kind of these corners, these kind of informal places where people can meet. This is the place where the musicians are, because they don't have their own table. They're always running around with their instruments, so we thought it was important to have a cafe for them. And then there was also this idea of making big kind of vertical connections. You can see how with the stairs, we place the stairs in the staircase once here, once here, once here. So when you go up, you're not just going up, 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 but you're kind of doing this promenade. You're kind of always seeing things from a different angle, always turning around. We were trying also to invent some crazy things, like, for example, these little shortcuts. This is the stair here. It just takes you one floor up. It's completely, well, I would not say useless, but it doesn't make sense at first. But because it doesn't make sense, it's nice. In a building where everything makes sense, it's cool to have something that doesn't make sense. It just, you know, some people will get used to it, and they use it, and it's like a little shortcut or something. And at the place where the tall building and the flat building were coming together, we were actually able to convince them to leave this space open. It's going all the way up to the roof, and it's actually kind of giving you an idea of the, like I said, of the former kind of crazy spatiality which it had. And then you can see themes like we were seeing in the small house before, this kind of inner perforation, the kind of stairs, the podests, you can look across and so on. Then, in this project, finally we were allowed to do this fifth facade, which everybody always is talking about, it's never happening. And we had a huge roof, and the city of Zurich actually explicitly wanted that. They were calling for outdoor space. So up on that roof, we were doing this promenade here. On the outside and on the inside, a kind of a wild garden. It's Mediterranean plants because the roof gets very hot in summer. There's not so much water. And you have a completely different kind of an idea. When you're in there, when you're between those higher buildings, you feel like you're somewhere in the suburbs in a garden or something. So it carries you to a completely different space. Within the building, of course, the nicest thing was then to distribute the special places, like I said, cafe and so on. And it was also logical where to put them, always on the big paths. So for example, the library, that space would then be right next to that tall space, which I showed you before. Then the workshops would be mainly on the bottom floor, where they would be away, and not disturbed. This is a workshop for stage props, then special kind of studios for sound and film, and the workplaces of the students and so on. They all found their place in this urbanism, and always it was important to kind of open up the spaces, so we spent a lot of money on these fireproof glasses. Then the apartments, which I mentioned, they're up on top, they really have nice views. And then that special space, which I'll come back to now, that ramp. In the competition, we had actually said we would make a cultural boulevard, like a vertical kind of thing. And we would put there all those kind of special spaces, like the movie theater. And this is what it looks like today. This is the other entrance, the north entrance. It's actually a really, really monumental space, which we didn't design, which is already there, but we're kind of using it. And at night, when the building comes alive, it actually creates a very nice scenery, kind of like a kind of vertical urbanism, and they use it when they have parties, they actually use it as a kind of a second entrance. On the inside then, we did things like this. This is the entrance hall, which doubles as a cinema lobby, and which people use also for performing playing, so they are appropriating and so on. One floor up, we have this small chamber music hall. All the way up we have this crazy kind of organ playing place where they teach organists for church. They are kind of freaking out because it's all black, but we want to exactly that. And then what you can now observe is a very nice thing that's happening. People are putting in their second layer. So again, what's happening with all our projects, people are coming in, they're using it. This is very harmless. This is in front of the library. And this is in the big hall when they do exhibitions, they glue things on the floor and this insulation is not so good, so it's coming off and we leave these traces. So the palimpsest is happening there. There are cute little things like this. You know, the bear is meeting the wheelchair driver and the lady and the man. But there are also very interesting things now happening with the artists. Some of them are kind of becoming creative in the hallways, which enjoy a lot, and some of them are also going crazy a little bit, which then is a problem for the school. So in an urban piece like this, it's very interesting to see now how people are coming in and they're changing it, and there is a whole process of social kind of stratification going on, and orientation. What can we do with the building? How far can we go? Are we going too far? And there's battle between the art students and the principal, which is very nice. So I'll come to the last project, and now I'll show you why we believe that renovations can actually be even a tool for new architecture. A client came to us, he's a furniture producer, and he had bought this lovely parking lot. It's on the main highway of Switzerland, so it's a very, very good site to bring his brand to the main highway. We did a little kind of model search. This is the highway here. We said, your program is not very big. So what you want to do is, you don't want to go flat like those supermarkets here on the side. What you want to do, you want to take your whole program and you want to, you know, bring it up here, to make a tall building here, and to actually kind of make a sign to the highway, like a Venturian sign. But then the question was how to kind of rationalize that, or how to organize it internally. And we were actually fascinated still by this space, which is the cascading space in the high tower of Domiorella. That was always in the back of our mind. And all of a sudden, I think with Daniel, who said, why don't we organize that furniture department exactly the way that we did this space? This space came out of Tony. It was actually suggested to us by the building. It's this kind of stepping up space. And we said, oh, that's interesting. We can actually use that for the furniture department. We will have here the storage down here. We will have an entrance. And then we will do a series of kind of terraces in which they can show their furniture. And underneath the terraces here, they will have all their storage. So what they will do is they will show the furniture here, and they will store it here, and show it here, and store it here. And like this, we will have a high volume at the same time. And we will have a kind of a spectacular effect on the inside, which we know works on tone. So we did this building with a very minimal budget. We tried to put everything, all the money we had, we tried to put it into the space, not into the surfaces, because we knew that the furniture producer would then come in and he would show his furniture. And it's actually a building that was conceived in Tony Ayal and was just transferred to here. So I'll close with this, and I hope I've shown you some of the fun we have with renovations and some of the strategies which we like to use. And yeah, I hope I've inspired you, and I hope also that your own renovations will be wonderful.
Thank you, Mathias. That was very inspiring. That was tour de force of the adaptive reuse. Beautiful presentation and beautiful projects. Maybe I'll just start, if we open up the floor, just asking how the venturing out as a developer ended up. Yeah, I'm curious.
Well, we didn't make much money on that first building because we spent all the money on those crazy windows and so on. My sister lives there, we gave her a nice rebate also. So then we thought we became then very professional, and we bought a second building. And we built it, 7 apartments, a little bit bigger. And we sold all of the apartments except for one. And now we have a huge problem with our building, technically. It's a concrete building with a carrying facade, and the ceilings are hanging from that outer facade, and there is a huge noise problem. There are steel connections, so we may be going bankrupt soon, but I will see. When I go back to Switzerland on Tuesday, I will in the evening I will meet all these people, and we will talk.
Yeah, of course, so, you went
be careful
into another set of liabilities when we do that.
Definitely. So it's something to think about. And now also Daniel and I, we know why all these developers do such boring buildings, because they don't want to risk anything.
But I guess there could be some kind of partnership worked out, where you could maybe minimize some of the...
It would be wonderful if someone would carry the risk and we would carry the fun.
Okay, we actually managed to fill the room slowly. Is there who has questions?
Do you always renovate buildings, or do you actually build from scratch, from zero?
Well, of course we also do, but for the sake of the lecture, I try to condense it and just show you renovations. Also because our student here, Medine, is about renovations. We like to build new. We do it a lot. But I have to say that in Switzerland, probably half of our commissions are now renovations. Just because there is so much standing around. And for various reasons, people don't want to take it away, for money, or because it's protected, or because if they take it down, they cannot build as much. So I think it's a growing reality, and it's nice, because when you think in Switzerland, after the Second World War, they built more than in the entire time before. Also Turkey, sure. So we have been, For 3,000, 4,000 years we have been building our cities, and now we have more than doubled them in the space of maybe 50, 60 years or 70 years. So now I think we need some time also to digest and to settle and to kind of make, not just to go for quantity, but also to go for quality. And I think the many people are not happy with the cities because there is no sense of history or layers, and so I think now is the time also to add all that, to respect what's already there, or at least to look at it and see if it has potential. Now I know in Turkey there's a big problem with the quality of the built material. It's a huge problem. So it's probably not possible in the same degree, but when I see some of the things that are done now, you know, when they probably have to take down a whole part of Istanbul, they build it new. When you see what's happening and what the kind of city that is actually coming out of that, it's heartbreaking. Because again, it's so modern, and again, it's so binary, zero, one, there is no added layer of meaning, it's just, you know, new again. So always starting over and never settling in and never kind of, you know, feel starting to feel at home. And that's, to me, a little heartbreaking. But I think it's time to kind of start thinking how to deal with stuff. That's
that. Would you happen to have a suggestion for us, for architects, or for, I don't know, people living here?
I've stopped suggesting to Turkish people. No, also, you know, I think there's a problem. It's not transferable so much. So we are speaking, when we go to France, to Germany, we show our projects, people get very pissed off. Oh, you have so much money, you live in paradise, and so on. No, it's not like that. We have our own problems. But the trick now would to be, of course, and this is not me who has to tell you, but the trick would now be, of course, to exchange ideas across the cultural and the economic borders and have them to see what you can use in other people's work. So I have no suggestion, but maybe, I don't know, maybe there's something there. It's more like an offer or something, or like a kind of a, I mean, yeah. I mean, in Mazet, in Çukurova, now it's election time again, so everybody's building like crazy illegally. And, you know, our consul, there's a Byzantine church, and he came with a big dozer and he took down the walls, and he put 1 meter on top of the whole terrain with this molos, and now on top of that he's building a house. Now, I mean, what is this? What kind of attitude is it? Why is it allowed? Why is no one stepping in? Why is it not? Is it a cultural question or is it an economic question? Or what exactly is it?
It does come down to ethics and to culture in a way. I mean, so maybe those people who are doing that, they think it's totally okay. Whereas in some other parts of the world, people say, I can't do this.
Maybe it's the good thing about it is he doesn't have a foundation, so he's building on top of the molos, so he's protecting actually the huge mosaic, which I know is underneath. You could think about it, you know, if you want to be positive, you can think about it that way. He's doing a kind of a kurama thing, yeah? But on the other hand, maybe really there is kind of a need for starting to look at things, understanding and also seeing the worth, and slowly growing accustomed to that. I think there is a desperate need in all places.
Have you ever worked in China?
Yes.
What was that like?
Terrible.
No, I would like to know more, because of course the change in Istanbul, where it's fast, but it's also not super fast. I mean, we always defend Istanbul on the basis that it's sort of a mediocre city in terms of, like when you compare it to China, India, whatever, like other developing cities and other developing contexts. So I would be very curious what how a Swiss German office operates in China, which should be the absolute kind of opposite in some ways.
You're right, we don't. We did, well, I'll use the guy again, but it short. So we, you know, this orders 100 thing, and we were before this. So what happened was a friend of ours worked at Pelton Gumeron. She went back to China and she knows Ai Weiwei. And Ai Weiwei knew the guy who was doing orders 100, Cai Zhou. And this guy needed some, I would say, like experimental people who would do the first wave. So they invited us and a few friends and we did some houses for them. And it was completely lost in translation, the whole thing. But crazily enough, somehow that guy and I, we got along very well, maybe because he likes to smoke cigars, and I was also smoking cigars with him, and then he invited us to be part of a competition for a huge school, as big as Tony Ariella. But it's a school, it's a boarding school for 3,000 students, age kindergarten to, lycée. 3,000 students.
From scratch.
From scratch in the desert somewhere. In this crazy new city which they just put to the desert. So we said, we went there and we looked at the competition and he said, don't worry, you will win. So we went there and we did a project and there was nothing, it was so difficult, there was nothing there to touch, there was nothing to start from. So we started actually from that idea, how terrible is it if a kindergarten child goes to a boarding school? A five-year-old child has to live his whole life in a place. So we organized the whole project in groups of families. It was like we developed a social project. We handed it in and we tried to add some kind of Chinese, Mongol, it was Inner Mongolia, some Mongolian kind of cultural stuff which we didn't understand at all. So again, that was maybe cynical in hindsight. So we went there and we were actually invited to the mayor's office 1 month before the official deadline and we showed him the finished project. He liked it very much. And then there was competition day and our team flew over and they presented everything and all the other teams had like these big documents and we had one letter because they told us to come up with a fee. And apparently our fee was 10 times as high as the fee of the next team. And we won the competition. Uh-huh. So, and then they, we were very happy, we said, yeah, cool, cool, and then they said, yeah, the fee, we have to talk about it. Half of that fee you will never see, we'll work with some places. Some of the money we can give you, but not really, and we have to, can we just have the digital files, please? There's a huge office in Beijing who will do the work for you. And I tried desperately to get into contact with him. I flew several times in Beijing. I tried to do Guangxi, good relations with the guy and so on. I don't actively corrupt people. But I said, if you want, I can invite you to Switzerland. I can invite you that recommendation letter. I will not pay for it, but you can blah, blah, blah. Not a chance. And now it's built. We've never been there. We've seen on Google Earth, you can see it, it's there. We've seen pictures of some American tourists and some teacher who was shown that school. It looks remotely like our renderings. Yeah, that's the end of it. So in this kind of a cultural context where you have to create from nowhere and also you lack a complete understanding of the culture and also the socio-economic context and you are not also finding your way in the bureaucracy yet, I think it's useless. Then you are just a kind of a pretext for them to, you know, throw around the money among themselves.
Your valuable part of the process is still for giving the first idea.
Maybe. If that's enough. I mean, in that time we could have done another project and probably we would have been closer to the real life of it. So it's a question of, I don't think it's possible to translate into any context. I think there are certain limits. And the thing we learned in China actually is that we are Europeans. And that was a very valuable lesson. We understood ourselves much better. The kind of city we like, the kind of discussion culture we like, the kind of work we like to do. We are very slow also.